In this video, we're looking at a particularly challenging trigonometric integral. It's the integral of square root 1 plus sine x on the interval 0 to pi. And I actually wrote this problem during the pandemic because I had too many students copying solutions from Symbolab. And this was intentionally designed to break Symbolab. So this integral is weird enough, where a lot of computer algebra systems will fail to compute the integral. And I wasn't too terribly mean with this problem. I actually gave a lot of hints on how to proceed with the problem because it's so exotic. So as you can see, Symbolab has given up and it says it's just evaluating using a numerical calculation method. But there are actually two different ways of evaluating this integral symbolically and getting an exact answer of 4. And one of them is to use an exotic combination of trigonometric identities to manipulate this integrand until it simplifies. But the first one that occurred to me was to use a conjugate. So we're going to multiply the numerator and denominator by the conjugate of that interior. And the point of that is to intentionally build a difference of two squares, which then opens up a trig identity approach. So that conjugate is the square root of 1 minus sine x. Again, the whole point of this is to intentionally build a difference of two squares. So when we multiply the interiors of these two square roots, we get 1 for the first term, the cross terms cancel, and then we get negative sine squared x for the second term. And this is where we get the payoff of the conjugate strategy. 1 minus sine squared is cosine squared. And this is probably the hardest point about this whole approach to the integral. You can't just say that the square root of cosine squared x is just cosine of x. And the reason why is that the square root of the square of a thing is always going to be positive because squaring it makes it positive, and then you square root it and you get the same magnitude as whatever you're squaring in there. We get the same magnitude as cosine x, but it's guaranteed to be positive. In other words, we're talking about an absolute value and this has to be treated very carefully. So if that's not totally clear, then just let me give a simple example really quick. If I take the square root of the square of negative 2, for example, that gives me the square root of 4, and that's positive 2. So I plug negative 2 into this thing and positive 2 pops out. This is just another way of saying the absolute value function. So how do you deal with an absolute value of cosine of x inside of an integral? Well, you have to understand where the cosine function is positive and where it's negative. So here's a picture of the cosine function on 0 to pi. And it crosses the x-axis at pi over 2. And I can see the cosine function is positive from 0 to pi over 2, but negative from pi over 2 to pi. So we're going to have to split this integral into two pieces, one for each of those signs. Where the cosine function is positive, the absolute value does nothing, and I get the integral of cosine x over the square root of 1 minus sine x dx. And where the cosine function is negative, the absolute value multiplies it by negative 1. So on this interval, pi over 2 to pi, the absolute value of cosine x is negative cosine of x, guaranteeing that we get a positive output. Now we can finally get to the work of finding the antiderivative of each of these integrands. And for each of these, I notice that I have a 1 over square root 1 minus sine x, and then I have the derivative of the interior function. So the interior function here is 1 minus sine x. The derivative of that is negative cosine x. So I'm so close to having that tacked onto my integrand. In other words, I'm recognizing the results of the chain rule. So in my first integral, I'm going to supply that minus sign to the cosine of x in the numerator and compensate for it out in front. In my second integral, I already have the minus sign, so I don't need to worry about supplying an extra factor of negative 1. Now, just to make it exceptionally clear how to get the antiderivative, I'm going to rewrite the 1 over square root 1 minus sine x as 1 minus sine x to the negative 1 half. Now, when I look at each of these integrands, I'm seeing 1 minus sine x raised to a power, and then the derivative of that interior function tacked on right next to it, so I can recognize the chain rule backwards. If you prefer, you could do an explicit u-substitution, and what you would do there is let u equal 1 minus sine x, and then du would be negative cosine x dx, so you'd be ready to go ahead and use the power rule. I prefer the approach of just directly using the chain rule backwards here. So we apply the power rule, and we end up with 1 minus sine x to the 1 half power. We're adding 1 to the exponent there, and then dividing by the resulting exponent. Well, dividing by 1 half is the same as multiplying by 2, so I get negative 2 times the quantity 1 minus sine x to the 1 half, evaluated from 0 to pi over 2. We do the same thing with the second integral, and it's really just the same integrand, so we already know what the answer is. I end up with a 2 times the quantity 1 minus sine x to the positive 1/2, evaluated from pi over 2 to pi. Now we can sub in our limits of integration and simplify the result. So I notice when I sub in the upper limit on the first one, I plug in pi over 2 for x, and the sine of pi over 2 is 1, and that gives me 1 minus 1, which is 0. So that's gone. I then subtract what I get when I sub in the lower limit. Well, the sine of 0 is 0, so I just end up with a 1 to the 1/2 in that piece, and 2 times that is just 2. All right, we're subtracting that lower limit, which gives us a positive 2 as our result. In my second term, if I sub in pi for x, the sine of pi is 0, and I end up with a positive 2 for that upper limit. Then I subtract what I get when I sub in the lower limit, which is that same thing, pi over 2. If I replace x by pi over 2, I end up with 1 minus 1, and that's 0. So we end up with a 2 plus 2, or 4, for the numerical value of this integral. There's one other point I want to mention for the particularly rigorous among you. And that is, if I go back to this step where I've split the integral into two pieces, I notice that subbing in pi over 2 for x creates a zero denominator. In other words, this is actually an improper integral, and the second integral is as well. If I sub in pi over 2, I get a zero denominator. That means these are actually improper integrals, and to handle these in a technically correct way, you would want to replace the problematic limiting point with a variable. We usually use a t for that. And then take the limit as t goes to pi over 2 from the left for the first integral. Take the limit as t goes to pi over 2 from the right in the second integral. So you just replace the problematic limit with a t. You do the antiderivative exactly the same way we did. You take the limit as t goes to pi over 2, and you're going to find the same answer. There's nothing problematic in these limits. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.